Pegang,
Pegang, pegang.
pegang.
Pegang. Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Hello. Just 1 minute. Participants chat share screen. Can you see all the presentation?
Yes, 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 yes. Right now, it is okay, sir. Yeah, see.
Everyone joined or can we start actually?
Yes, yes, you can, sir.
We can start, right?
Yes, yes.
It's already.
Okay, so. Yeah, so thing is, cardiac hemodynamics is a very important part of your exam presentations. Actually, you will have a lot of weightage for your spotters, especially this year. We might not have, because of the COVID pandemic, we are not exactly very sure how the exam pattern is. Like in DNB, you have virtual cases and OSCE, which is a very important role right now. This was actually a small substation for us, but this might be a very important mark scoring station in your exams. So, I'm just mainly concentrating on the oximetry run part of it because pressure tracing has been done about 10 days back by Dr. Thomas. So we've been mainly dealing with oximetry run. So what is important is actually sequential and systematic reading. So that is, and I have around 18 cases. So we'll try to analyze each case and see how to read properly. Okay. So I would actually require to actually read this. Read one of the for analyzing the cases. Okay, so you could please turn on your cameras. Get to know each other. Because I know some of you people, but I don't know some of other people actually. So please just turn your cameras on. Presentation is mainly focused on your exams, on your DM exams. Okay, so what matters is not your diagnosis. That is a very important part. The diagnosis does not matter at all. In fact, you won't get something like a straight away case like ASD, or you won't get something like VSD. Okay, they'll ask you some very complicated case, but it is essentially how you analyze each and every part of it. Case actually matters. It is not that you don't suddenly jump into a diagnosis. You don't just suddenly say it is like RSOV to RV with. You don't say a diagnosis like that. You have to analyze each and every step. That carries more weightage rather than jumping and saying a diagnosis RSOV to RV. Your diagnosis may be wrong. For example, in my spot, I could not find the diagnosis, but the analytical step should be there. That is what they appreciate. So it is your approach that count, and never jump and say the diagnosis and evaluate each and every step. So that is what is actually important. Just hold on 1 minute. Okay. So that is what is actually important. So keeping that in mind, we shall go for the first case. Okay. Is that okay with everyone? Okay. So I need one person to actually volunteer to read the case, so that we can go forward with this. There's no point in me just reading the case. Okay, so please consider. So this is how it is, pressure data. Or either you can
start. Yes. Who is that?
You can either start with pressures or either you can start with oximetry. So among
that action, can I start?
So pressures, you first read normal or abnormal. So you see the pressure, normal or abnormal. Link the pressure to next in line. See the gradients, compare if it's an ASD, compare RA versus LA, compare RV versus LA. So if you the RA is A6 before minus 6. So RV is 20 by 6. So then we compare the pressures. You have a tricuspid valve. So you look for a diastolic gradient across the tricuspid valve. So 6 by 6, there's no diastolic gradient. Again, RV to PA, 20 by 6 and 20 by 10. You look for a systolic gradient across the pulmonary valve. Then you look at your pulmonary artery wedge, that's a diastolic gradient. Look for the diastolic gradient as the arrow shows. Okay, then you look for the LV. Again, look for the systolic gradient across the mitral valve, and then diastolic gradient across the mitral valve and systolic gradient across the aortic valve. So this will be you as you analyze more cases, you'll be more confident. So I hope this proves to be useful. So we'll go for the first case. I think Dr. Ashwin has volunteered. So, Ashwin, can you just read this? And what is your impression based on this?
So, I'll first read the oximetry.
It's your choice. Yeah, it's your choice.
I'll first read the oximetry.
Or the pressure, that's your choice.
Okay. Yeah. The SVC saturation is 68.
Okay.
So it is fairly point? Normal. Yeah, mildly reduced.
Okay, 68 is reasonably okay. Yeah.
Okay. Then RA saturation is 70.
Okay. So what is the common?
That is normal, expected. Okay. It should be similar to SVC or slightly higher than the SVC.
Okay. Yeah.
Because IVC saturation is higher.
Yeah.
Then RV, it is 84.4. So there is a step up of 14, which is a significant step up from RV to RA to RV level.
Then
the same saturation is reflected in the pulmonary artery.
Okay.
And on the left side, it is normal saturations. Exactly. Expected normal saturations.
RA pressures?
So now coming to pressures. RA pressure is A wave is 7, V wave is 5, and mean is 6. It's okay, within normal limits. Okay. RV pressure, systolic pressure is elevated. It is 110 millimeter mercury. And the diastolic pressure is 7. There is no diastolic gradient across the tricuspid valve.
Exactly. So there's no diastolic gradient. Okay.
RV to pulmonary artery, there is a mild gradient of 10, which is not very significant.
Yeah.
RVOT obstruction.
Okay.
Then coming to left-sided pressures, LA pressure, AV and mean are, mean pressure is
elevated
14. Elevated. Mean LA pressure is elevated. And LV pressure is almost similar to RV pressure, lower than the RV pressure.
Okay.
And the aortic pressure is 130 bar
70.
70.
So is there a systolic gradient? Is there a systolic gradient across the aortic valve?
No, no systolic gradient. IOT pressure is higher than the.
What are your comments and what is your diagnosis? What is your comments and what is your diagnosis? So you have identified a step up at the level of RV, right?
RV, yeah.
Okay, you have identified a step up at the level of the RV. So what would be its common cause?
Common cause is a VST.
VST. So if it's a step up,
confusing part is,
if there's a step
aortic, up, aortic pressure is higher than both ventricles.
Okay, that is okay. We're not dealing with the top physiology, nah, for that all pressures to be equal. It may or may not be a top physiology. So you have anyway dealt with a step up at the level of the RV, whose common cause is a VST, right? So, yes. Is it left to right or right to left shunting?
It is a right to left to right shunting only.
It's a left to right shunting. Okay. And is there PAH or
not? There's no desaturation.
Is there PAH or not?
There is a PAH.
Is this severe PAH or mild PAH?
Pulmonary systolic pressure is
100.
100.
So, severe PAH.
Severe PAH.
So, it's a VSD with the left to right shunt with severe PAH.
Severe PAH.
Okay. So, is it operable or not?
It's not severe PAH, not operable. You are actually you have to calculate the PVR.
You can calculate, okay, but just roughly you can if you say is it operable or not.
It is a pre-Eisenmenger state, nearly not operable.
See, it's still shunting. It's a huge shunt from left to right, no? Because there's a massive systemic increase in saturation from 70 to 84. Even if you look at the LA pressures are also high. So if you have a severe PH, you're bound to have low LA pressures. Okay. So actually, this is still operable.
Okay.
You get my point. Because there's a huge.
Since we have good LA pressure. Okay.
There's a huge step up with a large LA pressures. So it's actually VSD with the severe PH, but with still shunting left to right and operable. So that is your impression from this case. So even if you do your echo, you might see significant.
Can I ask, how is the aortic pressure 130 bar 70?
Maybe the patient has hypertension. We are not very sure.
But still, it cannot be more than any of the ventricle, no?
Yeah, that is actually okay. That is logical only.
That is the confusing part of this.
That is logical. Again, there are a lot of fallacies of taking in cath data, if you can see. There's a given pressure tracing. From the given pressure tracing, you read is, yeah, there are some points you missed. So when you start reading, the SVC saturation is 68. It means that the comment is, the patient is actually very stable. Okay, if you have a low SVC saturation, like 35 or 40 or 50, it means
the patient is in reduced cardiac output or systemic desaturation.
Yeah, systemic desaturation or reduced cardiac output. Then what you do is you compare between the SVC and the aortic side. So if the aorta is also desaturated, it means the systemic desaturation. However, if the aorta is something like 97 and the SVC has saturation of 35, it means that you have a very sick patient on table. Okay, that is usually the first question they ask. Okay, what is your comment on the SVC? Especially if you have low SVC saturation, the first comment they ask is, what is your comment on that? So you have reasonably good SV saturation, reasonably normal. Okay, RA pressures are good. This is a step up with the level of the RV. Okay, and the pulmonary artery pressures, pulmonary arteries, there's no step up. LA is normal, LV is normal, IATA is normal. And when you comment, RAA 7, V5, M6 pressures are reasonably okay, and the patient is in sinus rhythm because you can have an AV. All right, so you missed that point. Then when you read about the RV pressure, RV systolic blood pressure is high, diastolic blood pressure is low, and there is no diastolic gradient across the tricuspid band. So MS6 and RV is 7, right? Then you must try to see in RV and PA, is there any systolic gradient? There is not much systolic gradient across the pulmonary valve. So now we go for LA. A and V are elevated, MS14, V is greater than A as expected. So you have high. So the LA pressures are high in a patient of who is having a left or right shunt, is actually indicates the patient is operable. Right? So LV is good and IOTA is good. So based upon this, you try to comment on this. So VSD, severe PH with left or right shunt, and the patient is operable. Right? So any doubts on this from any of the audience?
Chata, that gradient is expected on between the LA and LV. Mean LA pressure and the LV and diastolic.
Mean LA pressure and the mean LA pressure. Okay.
LV
14.
LV 9.
Yeah, there is a 5 millimeter gradient actually. Yeah, that is okay. That is, but actually, even if you take mitostenosis, you need to have a higher gradient, right?
Even if
you take a Coues formula, it's not that much of a gradient.
Okay.
It should be a significant gradient, right? So we are clear on this. So as you cases go by, you'll have more complicated cases. So anyway, the method of how you read this is like this. So it's VSD, severe PH, left to right shunt, operable, right? So this is a usual question. The next question they'll ask is, what are the causes of step up in the ventricular level? So one is a VSD, which shunts left to right. One is an RSOV to RV. One is coronary AV fistula to RV. And one is PDA with PR. Again, you get how PDA with PR gives you, right? PR yes. Goes into the ventricle. So VSD, RSOV to RV, coronary AV fistula to RV, and PDA with PR. You have also a lot of rare causes. They know usually these, you share at least these four causes. Okay. Are we clear on this? Right. So next case. So again, 9 month old child or baby who underwent a palliative procedure on day 40 of life. Okay. Would anyone care to read this?
Chata, can I try?
Yeah, you can try it, no problem.
SVC saturation is 54, that is low.
Yeah, low. So again, you should be, then when once you look at SVC saturation, you straight away look at the, it can be either due to low cardiac output state or due to systemic desaturation.
Okay.
So you look at the aortic pressure. Aortic pressure is also low, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so again.
Then RA is almost same as SVC.
RA is okay, fine.
255, there is no
step up. Yeah.
RV? Then from RA to RV, then from RV, RV to PA, there is a step up.
Of 20. diastolic gradient across the tricuspid. Don't miss that step. Is there a diastolic gradient across the tricuspid valve?
No, there's no diastolic gradient.
Don't miss that gradient. You must always see gradients across valves. Right, next.
From RV to PA, there is a gradient.
Systolic gradient.
Systolic gradient. Systolic gradient. From 100 to 10.
80.
Okay. 80 millimeters gradient. Then diastolic pressure is normal.
Okay.
Then LA pressure mean is 8 normal.
Okay.
Then LV systolic pressure is normal, 100. There is no gradient across the mitral valve.
Okay. Diastolic gradient.
There is no diastolic gradient, yeah. Okay. Then aortic pressure is 100 by 30. That diastolic pressure is very low with a wide pulse pressure.
Okay. And is there a systolic gradient across the aortic valve?
There is no systolic gradient.
Okay. So what are your impressions and what is your diagnosis?
So patient underwent a palliative procedure on day 40.
Yeah.
So there is a step up from RV to PA, significant step up.
Okay.
So that could be due to a shunting at the great vessel level.
Okay.
It could be either PDA.
Okay.
Or an AP window.
Okay.
And there is a step down from LA to LV.
Okay.
That could be.
I think Ashwin will tell me this. What about the pressures? There's something unique about the pressures in the chambers. With that itself, you can get a diagnosis.
Can I try?
Equalization of systolic.
Yeah, exactly. See, when you note the RV systolic BP is equal to the LV systolic BP, which is equal to the aortic BP. So what does that signify? It's a hallmark of a certain condition. What is it?
Tetralogy of Fallot.
Exactly. So tetralogy of Fallot, the abnormality in cath study is the RV systolic BP is equal to LV systolic BP is equal to aortic systolic BP. That is correctly exactly 100. So when you see the first thing which you should strike is, it is a tetralogy of Fallot. So if you look at it, exactly, there should be a large unrestricted VSD, right?
Okay.
And is there keeping that in mind, is there a severe PS?
Severe.
Yeah, severe PS. So you have a severe PS with shunting of blood towards the mixing of blood. So right, that's why you have a desaturation the level of aorta, right? So basic diagnosis is stop. This tetralogy of Fallot. You have a severe PS with an unrestricted VSD. Are you clear on that? Okay, yes. So what is the palliative procedure on day 40 of life?
Maybe BT shunt.
Exactly. So what is indicative of a BT shunt here?
The pulse pressure, wide pulse pressure in the aorta.
What could be the level of the pulmonary artery? Diagnosis, stop, physiology, VSD, large unrestricted VSD with severe PS with BT shunt. Okay,
yes.
That is responsible for the large pulse pressure. Again, see, your diagnosis is not important. It is just how you analyze it. Even if you are not able to reach the diagnosis, it does not actually matter. As long as you're even able to say all these steps. Does anyone have a doubt on this case? No doubts. Okay, fine. So we'll go for the next case. Okay, so diagnosis. So aortic saturation is decreased, but aorta is still more than the PA. Step up at the level of PA level. LV systolic BP is equal to RV systolic BP is equal to aortic systolic BP. Large unrestricted VSD, severe PS. So talk with the BT shunt. All right. So one of the general dictums, as soon as you get your hemodynamic study, oximetry study, straight away you look at the aorta and pulmonary artery. The first thing you look is the aorta and pulmonary artery saturation. Okay. Pulmonary artery is more than normal. Suppose the pulmonary artery saturation is something like 75. Or suppose pulmonary artery is 85. Then you can straight away say as a left right shunt. The aorta is less than normal, you think of a right to left shunt. If the pulmonary artery is much more than the aorta, you start thinking of a TGA. If the pulmonary artery is equal to aorta, you think of an admixture physiology. So this is a very important step. First thing you get in such a thing is, before reading anything, straight away in your mind, you look at the pulmonary artery and the aortic aorta. Pulmonary artery is more than normal, left to right shunt. Aorta is less than normal, right to left shunt. Pulmonary artery is more than the aorta, TGA. Pulmonary artery is equal to aorta, admixture physiology. All right? So once you diagnose a TGA, so I'll give you an example. Suppose you diagnose TGA based on this step. PA is more than TA saturation is more than the aortic saturation, you diagnose a TGA. You know TGA is incompatible with life, so there should be a shunt at some level. So you look for as an ASD, VSD or PDA, right? And then you look for the presence of a PS. That's how you diagnose it. The first thing, if you diagnose TGA, next step is you look for a bias or shunt. Only the patient will be alive. Then is there a PS or not, right? So this is a very important thing, okay? You clear on this? We'll go for the next thing. So again, 32-year-old male, sudden onset chest pain with heart failure symptoms. So who's reading this? Smitty there? Smitty? Not there. Okay. Anyone else? Sobin?
I shall read. Shall I read? Danush.
Danush.
I would like to start with the saturation.
Okay.
SVC saturation is 70.
Okay, then you comment on this. Simultaneously, you must comment on this.
Yeah, it's 70, which is quite higher than normal.
Okay, normally what we look at, the mixed venous oxygen saturation. Again,
yes,
people are lazy. They only look at the SVC saturation. Again, SVC saturation is pretty decent. Even that alone is pretty good enough. Okay, so SVC saturation is good. So patient is stable. Okay.
At the RA level, we are having a step up of 16 from 70 to 86.
Okay. So significant.
It shows step. That. It's a significant step up. Okay. Then at the RV level, we are having a step down of 6 millimeters mercury.
Okay.
Then at the PA level, we are having a pressure of 80.
Okay.
So, a saturation. Saturation of, okay. Of 80 is there. Then coming to the, in the left side, LA, LV and aortic pressures are expected.
Okay.
Maybe a bit desaturation is there in the LV and the aorta level, 95.
Okay, fine.
Very
okay.
Slight.
But again, it's not a significant desaturation.
See, so, right now,
cath readings, if you have to run cath studies, you know, the oximetry run can be markedly different. Sometimes we'll have to keep the patient there and then again do a repeat cath study if it doesn't qualify. So, okay.
Yes,
so,
yes.
LA, LV.
So, right now, we are having a step up at the RA level and a step down at the RV level.
Okay, step down on the RV level, you can keep it plus minus. Okay, let's keep that.
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Then at the pressures level, so what we are not having any A or V waves, so I'm not able to say whether the patient is in sinus rhythm or not.
Okay.
But mean RA pressures is elevated.
Definitely elevated, yeah.
And at the RV pressure, this I think it's a mean, RV systolic pressure.
Yeah.
Okay, RV mean pressure is 36. That is also quite elevated. And okay. The pulmonary artery pressures is 36 bar 18.
Is there a systolic?
No, there is gradient? A mild. No, there is no systolic gradient between RV to PA.
So then? What about the diastolic pressures?
The diastolic pressure in the pulmonary artery is also elevated.
So you must tell
so that. So both the pulmonary artery systolic and diastolic pressures are elevated.
Okay.
The LA mean pressure is also elevated, 16.
Okay.
And coming to the LV, we are having the LV systolic pressure is elevated at 158 bar 9.
Okay.
And also in the aorta, we are having, but there is no systolic gradient between the LV and the aorta.
Okay.
And we are having a wide pulse pressure situation with 160 okay. bar 30.
So your comments, your final comments and your diagnosis.
So there is a step up in the RA level with
okay.
With a high pulse pressure. So
exactly.
There may be a left to right shunting at the atrial level,
okay.
With and adding it with the high volume pulse, it may
okay.
be an RSOV to the right atrium.
Okay, that's the answer.
Also there's pulmonary artery mild pulmonary artery hypertension.
That could be some hyperkalemic PH due to flow.
Yes.
Okay. Why this is, you straight away forget about this clinical presentation. Even the clinical presentation suggests of an RSOV. Okay. Did everyone get why this is an RSOV to RA? Is there any doubts on this? Why this is an RSOV to RA? Why is this not an ASD? I straight away say this is an ASD. Why is this not an ASD? You forget about the clinical picture. The clinical picture. Why this is not an ASD?
The pressures are not equal between the left atrium and the right atrium.
Exactly. That is the point. See, when you have a large unrestrictive ASD, okay, if you pull the catheter from the LA to how do you distinguish a restrictive ASD and unrestricted ASD in cath is, one, of course, an unrestrictive restrictive ASD will not have significant step left right shunt, and hence you won't have a saturation difference there. When you pull a catheter from the LA to RA, if the mean pressure difference is less than 2-3, it indicates an unrestricted ASD, right? And then A will be equal to V and X will be equal to Y, right? But you look at this, the RA mean is 12 and the LA mean is 16, right? There is still, if this is an ASD, it is a restrictive ASD because the gradient is more than 2. But a restrictive ASD will never have such a large step up of 16. That is not possible. Okay. So it is ultimately not an ASD. And if you look with a large pulse pressure, the other diagnosis is an RSOV to RA, keeping a pulse pressure and the clinical symptoms in mind. So this is a very important point. You have to look, once you diagnose a step up at one level, you look at the LA and RA, or similarly LV and RV. The mean gradients are 4, the difference of 4. So it cannot, if it's an ASD, it has to be a restrictive ASD, and a restrictive ASD will never cause such a large step up. So it is definitely not an ASD. You have to think of something else. The clinical picture and the white pulse pressure would probably indicate an RSOV to RA. Okay. So step up at the atrial level, white presentation and the clinical presentation indicates an RSOV to RA. So what are the causes of step up at the atrial level? Again, frequently asked, ASD, RSOV to RA, VSD with TR. Again, you can understand VSD with TR, how it becomes. Gerbo defect, coronary AV fistula to RA, and PAPVC, right? So I have a question. He said there's a step down between RA to RA. Why has that occurred? It's a very simple question. There's no particular answer for this.
Screening.
Yeah, exactly. You might have taken the sample at the jet which originates from the LA to RA. If you suppose you take it a bit higher or a bit lower, you might get a different saturation. This might have been taking, you might get actually more of a saturated blood. That's why this might not have much significance. You must keep that also in mind, right? And I missed one point, a step up at the level of PA. This is also important for the last case. PDA, AP window, RSOV to RVOT, coronary origin of pulmonary artery, ALCAPA and BT shunt, right? So this is a very important table. What is a significant step up is, again, this is from a guy called Antman. Atria is 7%, ventricle is 5%, great vessel is 5%, any level is 7%. Okay. So atria 7%, ventricle 5%, great vessel 5%, any level. Suppose you take an SVC saturation and PA saturation, the difference is more than 7, there's some shunt going on somewhere, right? And PV to LA of more than 2% is significant. Which is, why is the LA have a lower saturation than the PV? To take the saturation be 100 and the LA saturation.
So bronchial veins.
Okay, bronchial veins draining. Okay, some people say there are unidentified veins draining. Not very sure on that. Okay, so 18-year-old asymptomatic acyanotic child, S2 wide split, 3/6 ESM at the base. So who's going to read this? Mitty and Mitty, try and read this.
The saturation, the SVC saturation is 72. That means child is, the boy is stable. RA saturation, SVC to RA, there is a step up of 13%.
There's a significant step up. Then, significant step up. There's a significant step up, okay.
Significant step.
Yeah.
Okay. From the artery has 55, slightly on higher side.
Okay.
Then primary L saturation is neither is no saturation.
Not able to hear you.
And diode saturation is 97, which is normal.
Okay. Pressure.
Then the pressures, the right atrial pressure, mean RA pressure is normal, and the and the patient is in sinus rhythm.
Okay.
There is a RV systolic pressure is elevated. There is no diastolic gradient across the tricuspid valve. RV systolic pressure is elevated. Then there is a step down of. No, there is a gradient across the pulmonary valve.
Okay.
The
systolic gradient.
Then.
You mean systolic gradient, right?
Systolic gradient across the pulmonary valve. Okay. Yes. systolic gradient across pulmonary wedge. Then pulmonary wedge pressure is normal pressure is 10.
And E is more than A as expected.
Everything is E is more than. And LV pressures are 100. There is no diastolic gradient across the mitral gland. And aortic pressures are pulse pressure is now.
Okay.
So there is step the level of VC to RA. So it could be an
effect. No, but again, the same point applies as in.
PAPVC.
Why it's a PA? Why it's not an ASD is the same point as discussed last time. You look at the mean gradient between, say, RA and pulmonary artery wedge pressure is 5. So if it has to be an ASD, it has to be a restrictive ASD. And restrictive ASD will not cause such a large step up. Right? So it's an unrestrictive, so it cannot be an ASD. Or if it is an ASD, it could be only a restrictive ASD. And so the large step up here would be mostly a PAPVC, right? Which is draining probably somewhere into the SVC or somewhere, I'm not very sure, but all low SVC. So it's probably a PAPVC. So, and in an ASD, A and B will be equal and X and Y will be equal. So it's an unrestrictive, so it's probably, so this is what I said, unrestrictive ASD, catheter pullback from the LA to RA, a mean gain difference will be less than 2. LV equal to V, X equal to Y. So it's PAPVC, it may or may not have a restrictive ASD. So it's not a clear-cut ASD. That's our important point. So whenever you diagnose ASD, always look for the, is there a pressure difference? Right? So we clear on this? We go for the next one. 1 minute. Yeah. So 12-year-old boy, 12-year-old, white fixed at S2, diagnosed clinically as ASD, was non-cyanotic. So Sobin is there?
Yes, sir. Actually, I'll start with the saturation. Okay. SVC saturation is 88.
Okay.
It's a bit on higher side, sir.
It's on higher side.
70, higher.
Yeah.
And SVC to RA, there is normal only. There is no difference in saturation. RA to RV, there is no significant step up. RV to PA also, it is normal only. And there is a left side LA, there is a
hello.
So yes.
Okay, LA, LV and femoral artery all are having desaturated,
all are equal data
and desaturated.
Yes.
It's still desaturated, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so comment on your pressures.
Pressure on the right side, pressures are elevated. Mean RA pressure is...
Yeah, you must say patient is in sinus rhythm.
Patient is in sinus rhythm. Okay. Mean RA pressure slightly is 6. Elevated. Slightly elevated. Slightly
elevated. Okay.
There is no gradient across the tricuspid valve.
Okay.
And RV systolic pressure is elevated.
Okay.
RV to PA, there is a mild systolic gradient is there.
Okay, again, that's not very significant. Na? 15 only, na?
Yeah.
Okay, then?
Then on the left side, there is mean pressure is patient. Mean
what is the comment on the PA diastolic pressure? Slightly on the higher side. Usually it's around 10. Na?
Yeah, slightly on the higher side.
LA pressures?
LA pressures are normal only. Mean pressure is 6.
Again, what is something, so something unique on the LA pressure? What is it?
A is equal to V.
Okay, that is one thing. Keep that in mind. Okay.
And there is both RA and LA mean are equal. So there are also some unrestrictive ASD.
Okay, ASD, right. Okay, so then next.
And... LV pressure is normal only. Femoral artery pressure also normal with normal only. Saturation, all the chambers are equal. So AST plus TAP, TAPVC might be the.
Okay, so I'm saying it's a TAPVC with ASG. So that is actually the correct answer. So see, the first thing I told you, whenever you get a tracing, always look at the PA tracing and the iota first. PA and iota. Here the PA and iota are almost the same. 88, right? Here the
femoral artery. I was searching for iota actually.
Here is the femoral artery. So both are 88. So both, if they are both same, it indicates an admixture physiology. Okay.
Okay.
Now if you see beyond RA, all pressures have roughly the same pressures. So either it is a tricuspid atresia or TAPVC. Are you clear on that point?
Yes.
So what admixture physiology mimics an ASD? It is TAPVC.
Okay.
Okay. So in this, the catch points are, one is you have a step up at the level of the SVC, right?
Okay.
And beyond RA and beyond it, all pressures have almost the same, all chambers have almost the same saturation.
Yes.
Right? The first thing, you compare femoral artery and pulmonary artery, both have equal saturations. That indicates an admixture physiology. Beyond RA, all chambers have the same saturation. So probably it is either TAPVC or tricuspid atresia. What mimics an ASD is TAPVC, right?
Okay. Yes.
Again, I have actually, so where is it draining? So you have, so we have diagnosed a TAPVC.
Yes.
Right. Is it a supracardiac TAPVC or intracardiac TAPVC?
Supracardiac.
Okay. Is it obstructed or non-obstructed? That is also important.
Non-obstructive.
Why?
LA mean is.
There's no pH. Obstructive has pH, na?
Obstructive.
See, obstructive has pH. Right.
Yes.
See, one again, see, a 12-year-old boy, if it's an infracardiac obstructive PAVC, it's unlikely to live for so long. It has to be a supracardiac non-obstructive. Okay, next question. Why is the patient non-cyanotic?
Dreaming.
Good pulmonary flow.
No, it's not. The reason is not that. See, you refer clinically in order for you to detect a cyanosis.
Cyanotic, no?
85. Clinically, for you to detect cyanosis, your saturation should be less than 85.
Okay.
Probably if you make this patient exercise, you might find a cyanosis, right?
Okay.
So in exams, you don't say a saturation of 90 and then go say the patient is cyanotic, okay?
Okay.
This is a very important point. So clinically, if you want it, it should be 85. So SVC saturation is increased because there is all the pulmonary veins are connected to the SVC. All chambers distal to RA have same saturation. PA pressure is mild elevation. TAPVC is supracardiac non-obstructive type. Clear on that?
Yes.
So first thing, look at the PA, look at the iota, both are same admixture physiology. Okay. So you start off with that. So 36-year-old.
Somebody has raised a question in the chat. I think they can ask.
Yeah, we can ask now. What is the problem?
I don't know. Somebody posted a question. What is the significance of elevated diastolic pressure? What was it?
One thing is an elevated diastolic pressure is indicated as an RV diastolic dysfunction, indicates the patient that the chamber could be failing. That is one important thing. So if you find an elevated RV diastolic pressure, it indicates that the patient for the chamber usually might be failing. So that's one thing to look for. It's not a very hardcore sign, it's a soft sign actually. I'm not able to assess that access the chat actually. Okay. So 36-year-old echo shows a VST with severe MR. Okay. So a CTVS guy comes and requests a pre-op CAG. Okay. You're any planning for a surgical closure, plus minus Y, mitral valve replacement. And the CTVS guy requested a pre-op CAG. So you decide, okay, we'll do a cath also. Anyway, we are taking up the patient in the cath lab, we'll do a cath also, and then we'll do a CAG. So who's going to read this? Is anyone apart from Tremendra Medical College there? I don't know, most of the people. Hafish and Hafish? Hafish is not there. Okay. So I don't know most of you guys. So let's say who has not read so far? Sham?
Sham Jatran.
Sham, read. Sham, read. Sham.
Okay. Yes, it's ready. Can you hear?
I can hear.
Yes, crystal clear.
Okay. So 36-year-old person with echo VST with severe MR. So the SVC saturation is actually 41.
Okay.
You can see that the aortic saturation is normal. So it is a low cardiac output state.
Okay, low cardiac output state. Okay. So once you diagnose that, you should be very careful in doing the procedure, right?
The log article said that you can see that the array pressures are actually 87. That means there is a significant step up at the level of the array level.
Okay.
And RV pressures are 90. All okay. RV saturation is 90. It's almost there's no significance. But PA pressures also okay.
Okay.
Pulmonary pressure is not available. LV pressures LA is not available. LV saturation is around 98. That is okay. Normal. And femoral artery pulse femoral artery saturation is also normal. Okay. Almost normal. Yeah, oh, and coming to pressure, you can see that there is a significant increase in the RA pressure. And RV pressures were actually RV systolic and diastolic pressures were elevated.
You have missed one point. That's why the systematic step by step. See, there is only V24. Where is the A?
V is 24. Is in AF. Maybe
AF fibrillation. So that is, you must never miss a point. That's why the patient is in atrial fibrillation.
Okay, patient is in atrial fibrillation. Okay. And atrial pressures, RA pressures were elevated also.
Okay.
Around 40. Then RV pressures were 80 by 10. That is a there is a
severe pH.
No, severe pH is a systolic pressures okay. Elevated, but there is no significant diastolic gradient.
Okay.
And pulmonary pressures were also elevated with 80/27, okay. And there is no significant significant systolic gradient between both.
Okay.
And pulmonary artery pressures were actually elevated again, elevated with a mean pressures of 23.
Okay.
And LV pressures were 90/11, and there is a significant diastolic gradient.
Again, see that gradient, you don't have the available A, so the mean might not be correct.
Okay.
So keep that in mind because patient is an AF. Na. Okay, next.
Yeah. Then femoral artery.
But the V is elevated, keep that in mind because patient has severe MR.
Okay. Then femoral artery pressures are 90/54.
Yeah.
And there is no significant systolic gradient.
Okay, so what are your comments?
So I think that at the level of RA, there was actually a significant step up. So there was actually a left to right shunt at the level of RA.
Okay.
And the level of RA, and there is a systolic pressures were at a lower side because of the associated less cardiac outflow into the left side of the heart. So that that means probably there is a when the ventricular septal defect that has been draining into the RA.
Ventricular septal defect draining into, you mean a Gerbod? Okay, possible, but Gerbod is rare. Now, I'll tell you what, actually I've missed certain points. So your first thing is when you consider a step up at the level of the RA, you must consider whether there's an ASD. Is there an ASD in this patient?
No,
because the mean LA pressures and the RA pressures are completely different, right?
So
that is done. Okay. So your diagnosis is VSD. Patient has severe pH, right? So VSD, severe pH. Now what can cause a step up at the level of the RA? If a patient has severe pH?
TR.
Exactly. So the patient has VSD with TR. The TR, that's why you must always, what are the other causes of step up? That is very important. So you have seen one as an ASD. Two TAPVC or PAPVC, three of seen an RSOV to RA. This is the fourth case. VSD with TR. See, it must be very clear. It's a pre-op echo has been done. No one is going to miss such a large ASD, right?
Okay.
No one can miss it, especially when you have a severe MR with an ASD, you have torrential flow across the valve.
Okay.
So you're not going to miss it. So there's obviously no ASD. No one is going to miss such a large ASD, right? So you have a VSD with severe TR. The TR is causing the step up in the RA.
Okay.
VSD and the patient is in atrial fibrillation with congestive cardiac failure. It's causing the low cardiac output state.
Okay.
So my question is, if it's such a large VSD, why is the pressures, you know, the VSD, the systolic pressures between both chambers will be equal, right? If it's a large VSD. The yeah. engine systolic and the RV systolic pressures both will be equal. Why it's not equal? One is 90 and one is 80. So what is the cause for it? So again, the VSD might be closed by a tricuspid leaflet or by an aneurysm. It's about to be closing or something like that. Okay, so it's actually a difficult case. Okay.
That's so, the pressure is really high.
That's why you won't get that equalization. It's partially being closed.
Okay.
Maybe the tricuspid leaflet is coming in impinging, something like that.
Okay.
So pressure is having AF. There are prominent B waves indicative of an MR. You got that clear?
Okay.
Huge step up at the RA level. The step up, the reason is a VSD with ER. It's not an ASD because there is significant mean pressure difference between the LA and RA. It's a low cardiac output state, right? Severe PAH.
Okay.
RV started the pressure is not equally started the pressure because I told you the reason why.
Okay.
So the first question is, will you do a pre-op CAG for this patient?
You have to do.
Again, see the
priority is a
low SVC saturation. Might collapse. When you inject the dye itself, the patient might collapse.
Okay.
So preferably don't do it at this point.
Okay.
You have such a low systemic saturation, such a low arterial blood pressure. Again, it's not advisable to do. Or if you do it with minimal amounts of dye, just to see. But be careful in doing it. Okay. If the patient has an infection, you treat the infection, do something. But it's not a run-of-the-mill CAG as per before. So always keep your eyes open in the cath lab. Right? Especially if you have a point of care device where you can see the AV, you can see the saturation immediately. Okay, so I had one more question from this actually. So, SVC, RA, RB, permanent. Okay, fine. This is so neonate, day 3 of life. Okay, so anyone apart from Trivandrum Medical College willing to read this? See a lot of people, but no one is willing to read this.
Hello, sir.
You are?
Sir Saurabh Kapadia from Mumbai.
From Mumbai? We have people from Mumbai. Which college?
Jaslok Hospital.
Jaslok. You're doing DNB there?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So your exam is right now OSCE based, right?
Yes, sir.
OSCE and 100 marks virtual case presentation, right?
We have to suggest that kind of exam here also.
No, but that is actually more different. You just imagine our professors with a virtual case. The others, you will have standard questions like dyspnea, grades of dyspnea, what is the limitations of NIA. Here, you won't have anything.
Right? That is there, but
just imagine our professors with this. Okay, forget about it. You can read about that. You can read it. You're in day 3 of life, right?
Yes, sir. So on this, aorta saturation is 62.
Yeah.
And pulmonary artery saturation is 98%.
Your diagnosis from that is?
Could be a TS of TGA.
Yeah, TGA. First, so once you see a TGA, you must see where is the level of shunt. So only then the patient will survive. So is the shunt at the atrial level, ventricular level, or ductus level? Okay. And is there PS or not? Okay. So you can read. Okay.
So there is a step up at the level of RA.
Okay.
Then step up at the level of pulmonary artery.
You can see the first thing you missed, the SVC saturation is very low, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then the pulmonary artery saturation is high. The pulmonary artery is the aorta in this case.
Yes, sir.
So there's a significant pressure saturation difference. It means that there is slow flow of blood through the tissues and there is more time for extraction. So the patient is in shock.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in this case, the patient is in shock. So the cath study must go on very carefully after this. If possible, call a senior colleague. Okay. So all those things are there. So the SVC saturation is low when compared to the pulmonary artery. In this case, the aorta. Okay. So next is the step up at the level. Okay, fine.
Can I ask one doubt?
Yeah.
When the aorta saturation is already 60, it is expected to be 36. No, with that alone, can we say he is in shock?
It's a TGA. Yeah, pulmonary artery.
I'm asking. Yeah. So SVC is expected to be 30. Oh, is it? Okay. Now I understand. Okay.
In this case, the PA is equal to the aorta and the aorta is equal to the PA.
Okay,
next.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So RV 2 aorta is connected. So 62%, 8 to 62. Then
there's no gradient. Is there a gradient? No gradient.
No gradient.
I mean, you're being saturation. I'm sorry. Saturation.
Yeah, saturation. Then left-sided saturations, 99%, 99%, and then pulmonary arteries connected, 98%. No step-up or step-down.
Yeah.
Then pressures, RA pressure is around 4. RA to RV, there is significant gradient.
RA to RV, that's a gradient. You look for the diastolic gradient, right?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah, diastolic rate, I don't think that much because again, it's a mean pressure.
Yes, sir.
So it's around 2 only.
Okay, sir. Then LA pressure is around 8 and RA pressure is around, mean pressure is around 4. So not a non-restrictive ASD is not present here.
You mean there's a restrictive ASD or a non-restrictive
ASD? ASD, sir. ASD is not.
Yeah, what is it, restrictive or non-restrictive?
Might be a restrictive ASD. ASD.
It's a restrictive ASD, right? Okay, fine. Yeah.
And then RV to aorta pressure is around 77/48. So blue output situation with mean of 58. Then LA pressure is around 8 and LV pressure is around 23/6.
Okay.
So LV and RV pressures are also different. So it is basically a restrictive ASD, no VSD.
Okay, so why is the patient in shock?
Maybe the ASD.
Diagnosis of TG, probably a restrictive ASD.
Yes.
Okay, why is the patient in shock? What, so again, it's day 3 of life, right? So what happens on day 3?
So the PDA is closing.
Yeah, PDA closes, right?
Yes, sir.
So it's a TGA with closure of the PDA probably, and that is caused the reason of shock. So what do you do now?
Sir, two options. Either you do balloon atrial septostomy or you start PG infusion and post the patient for intracardiac repair.
So PG infusion, you can start the patient on PG infusion. And you can plan for an immediate septostomy followed by curative surgery, right?
Yes, sir.
It's a fairly usually asked exam question, right?
Yes.
It's usually asked. So, first you look at the pressures, aortic pressure and the pulmonary pressure. And the pulmonary, is there a pressure? Both are, aorta is much more as a TGA. Then you look for where is the shunt level, atrial, ventricular, great arterial. And then you look for, is there a PS or not, right?
Yes, sir.
So, in this case, the patient is in shock because the PDA is closing.
Yes, sir.
And so, you do a PG infusion or immediate septostomy, right?
Yes.
So this is a 12, next question is a 12-year-old boy with an, it's an easy one. 12-year-old boy with an incidentally detected continuous murmur. Okay, who wants this?
Should I continue, sir?
If anyone is willing, let them try because there are a lot of people.
Okay, sir.
Anyone is there? Anyone wants? Okay, I don't think anyone is willing. So Arab, you can start, you can try.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Yeah. So here, aortic saturation is 86, around 86. So patient is cyanotic. And pulmonary artery saturation is around 70.
Okay, so then, the aorta is more than pulmonary artery.
Yeah.
Okay, no, but you can read, you always read that in your mind. So when you're given a table, you keep that in your mind and then, but you start telling from the SVC, right? Because the examiners don't want you to jump from aorta to pulmonary artery and all those things. So you start from above, but in your mind, you can read like that.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And so SVC to RA, no significant step up.
SVC saturation is good. Patient stable.
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir. SVC saturation is good. RA saturation, no step up.
Okay.
No step up at the level of RV also or pulmonary artery also.
Okay.
And LA to LV to aorta, saturations look little less, but there's no significant step up or step down.
It's desaturated, right?
Yes, sir. Desaturated.
Okay, anything less than 93 is desaturation. So again, pressures.
Pressures. So pressures at the level of right atrium is A7 and V5, mean of 6, and RV is 28/7.
First thing is patient in sinus rhythm with reasonably is maybe slightly elevated RA pressures because the mean is around 6. Patient in sinus rhythm, right? And A is more than B.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next is.
Then pulmonary artery pressure is 25/12. So no pH here.
Okay. LA?
LA pressure is around A wave is 10, V wave is 11, mean of 10.
Yeah, okay.
So LA pressure more than RA pressure.
Okay.
Then LV is around 110 by 9 and aorta is 110 by 70.
So what are your comments? What is the diagnosis?
This patient has a incidentally detected continuous murmur and patient is cyanotic. Yeah. There's no significant VSD here and no significant step up at the level of any chamber. So could be because of extracardiac condition like pulmonary AV fistula.
That's the answer actually. So the only abnormality you find is this uniform desaturation across all left chambers. So it's usually a pulmonary, it's an incidentally continuous murmur, it's usually a pulmonary AV fistula. Okay, low pulmonary artery, low pulmonary venous saturation, you think of, one is could it be a lung disease? You can have severe pneumonia, okay. You can have pulmonary edema, alveolar hypoventilation, or due to pulmonary AV fistula. In this case, the clinical condition is contiguous, measured with the pulmonary AV fistula, right? So the So the next one, 16-year-old boy who came for cataract surgery, right? So who's willing for this? I think I've shown you the answer. So let's see. So who wants to read this? No reason we lost Toronto Medical College guys to read it. Okay, so Ilyas is there?
Ilyas
is my junior actually. So that's it. I only know a few people among us. Ilyas there?
No, sir.
He's not there. Or he's silent.
Okay. Link.
So, who else is there who I know? I know not many people who I know. So, I think we can vote for. Okay, from anyone? No one is willing to read it.
Sir, I will.
Who is this?
Hello.
Yeah?
Hello.
Yeah, what's your name?
Sir, Surya, sir.
You are from?
Sir, Madras Medical College.
FMMC, right. It's a college where my MD.
Ilyas only sent me the link.
Yeah, Ilyas. Okay, fine. You just start reading.
Okay. Sir, SVC saturation and IVC saturation are fairly okay. The patient is not in at present desaturation.
Okay, so reasonably stable patient. Okay.
Stable patient. RA sat, there is no step up at the level of RA, atrial level or ventricular level.
Okay.
There is a significant difference between more than 7. I mean, at the level of great arteries, there is a shunt. Okay. Because there is a difference of more than 7.
Yeah, the left to right shunt.
Left to right. There is a level of left to right shunt.
Okay.
Pulmonary artery. I mean, left side saturations are normal.
Okay.
Coming to the pressure tracings. Pressure values. RA pressure is slightly high, mean of 8. I mean, patient is in sinus rhythm.
Okay. It's within me, as expected.
Mean is slightly high.
Okay.
With evidence of pulmonary hypertension is there.
Systolic BP is high. Systolic, diastolic.
Systolic is also.
Is there a diastolic gradient across the tricuspid wall?
Yes, sir.
Diastolic gradient, no?
Yeah, no, that is it. Systolic hypertension. There is no diastolic gradient.
Yeah, and is there a systolic gradient across the pulmonary wall?
Systolic gradient, no, sir.
Okay, no. So you must say that also.
Okay. So
you read it is more important than a diagnosis actually. So okay, next.
Okay.
So there is some degree of PA. That's what you're saying.
Okay. Pulmonary artery hypertension is
okay.
There.
So moderate at least. Okay.
There is a difference between pressure between right and left pulmonary artery thing.
Okay, see, compare the main pulmonary artery to the LPA. Is there a gradient?
Main pulmonary artery to
left and right pulmonary arteries. Is there a gradient?
Yes, sir.
So that is a gradient,
yeah. Difference is there. I mean, difference is there between main pulmonary artery and RPL. I mean,
or both. LPA, both. So both. In the pulmonary artery, a gradient of and coarctation is has the same gradient. More than 20 is significant.
Okay.
So it's more than 20 anyway, definitely there. So what do you infer from this? There's a gradient there. So what do you infer?
Pulmonary stenosis.
Branch pulmonary stenosis. Peripheral PS is there. Okay. The peripheral PS is causing the increased RV pressures. Okay. Right. The RV dies. Okay. Fine. Next.
Sir, then there is a are we left side is okay, sir. I mean,
V is more than A.
V is more than A.
Aortic pressures are normal.
Normal. So V is more than A. Normal. Aortic pressure is also, I mean, slightly low. I mean, okay, sir. There is a white pulse pressure is there.
Okay, white pulse pressure. Right. So, is there a systolic gradient from LV to aorta?
No, sir. No systolic gradient.
Elastic gradient across the mitral valve?
LV and the
mitral valve. So LV,
no.
So you have diagnosed a peripheral PS.
Peripheral right? PS.
Okay.
PD.
So
PD.
Yes, with PD. Why is there a PD?
Sir, there is a step up at the level of great arteries.
White pulse pressure, right?
With white pulse pressure.
So the diagnosis of peripheral PS with PD. What is the condition of the patient?
Balla.
He has come for cataract surgery.
Rubella.
Rubella.
Rubella. Rubella. Right?
Rubella. Yes.
Surya Ji. Surya sir was my senior medicine.
Oh, really? Where is he doing now? Where is he now?
MMC.
Cardiogen.
You are Sobin senior.
Yeah.
Did you rag him?
Sobin ulla iruka.
Sobin ulla iruka.
Okay, thank you.
So it's peripheral PS with PDA, diagnosed congenital rubella syndrome. Okay, so yeah. There's step up at the level of MPA, there's peripheral PS, high PA pressures, and high aortic pulse pressure. Diagnosed peripheral PS with PDA, congenital rubella syndrome. So, cause of peripheral PS, you have congenital rubella syndrome, Noonan, Allagail, Williams, Cutis, Laxa, and TOF. Again, TOF will have supravalvular stenosis, valvular stenosis, or subvalvular stenosis. One of the favorite exam questions is what are the levels of obstruction in TOF? Right.
What are
they? So, they can ask also what is the name of the classification of peripheral PS gaze classification. And if you are they are more bothered, they'll ask you what is type 1, type 2, type 3. Okay. So again, 4-year-old cyanotic infant. Okay. So who is going to read this? 4-year-old cyanotic infant.
Sir, I'm Mamsi, sir, from Hyderabad.
College?
Hello.
Which college are you from?
Star Hospital, sir. DNB.
Yeah, fine. You can read it, actually.
Yeah.
Four-day-old infant.
And the saturation data is showing high SVC, that is 72%, and low SVC, 80%.
Okay.
And IVC, 68%.
Fairly okay.
So SVC saturations are higher.
Yeah.
Higher than normal. Maybe some anomalous connection was there. And right atrial saturation is 88 and right ventricular is 89 and MPA is 90. All are around similar.
Okay.
And left atrial saturation and LV saturations are also similar.
Okay.
So maybe some anomalous connection is there. And coming to the pressure data, right atrial pressure is A wave is 11, V wave is 11 and mean is 11.
Okay.
Is sinus rhythm.
Yeah. A is equal to
sinus rhythm with A is equal to V. Maybe yeah. ASD is there.
Okay.
Large atrial septal defect is there. And right ventricular pressure is 60 and end-diastolic is 8.
Okay.
There is a 3 millimeters gradient across the right aspid wall. Maybe high flow situation.
Okay.
The pulmonary artery pressures are 60 systolic and 33 diastolic.
There's no systolic gradient.
There is no systolic gradient and higher mean pressures are there.
Yeah.
42 and left atrial pressure is A is 10 and V is 11 and mean is 10.
Okay. Now if you and compare, is there a gradient between
diastolic mean right atrial pressure is 11 and left atrial pressure is 10. Sir.
If it's an ASD, it's an unrestricted ASD. Right.
Only 1 mm gradient is
this. Yeah, so less than 2, na? So if there is an ASD, it's an unrestricted ASD.
Yes, sir. Unrestricted ASD. Right. Non-restricted ASD. And LV is, LV systolic is 100 and diastolic is end diastolic 7. And diastolic gradient is 3, sir, between LV and LV. And aorta is 100 systolic and 70 diastolic. There is no systolic gradient across LV to aorta.
So diagnosis is?
Diagnosed, it is a total anomalous pulmonary venous connection.
Okay.
Maybe into the supracardiac.
Okay, but again,
supracardiac total.
I'm very sure. Supracardiac, but could be obstructive also, na? Because there's pulmonary artery. Not very sure.
Left atrial pressures are not much elevated.
Okay, also there. Okay.
Anyway, we don't know whether pulmonary capillary wedge.
The supracardiac TAPVC, which is with an ASD, large unobstructive ASD, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so again, one easy method is look at the PA pressures, look at the MPA saturation, look at the aortic saturation. Both are almost same. Okay, so that indicates an admixture physiology. All chambers have the same saturation beyond RA. So it's a TAPVC or a tricuspid atresia. Okay, and then you try to find out which one it is. All right.
And how this capillary wedge pressure is not there, no sir. How to find out whether it is
obstructive, whether congestion is there? Again, okay. Because it's difficult. How do you enter the pulmonary veins in TAPVC? It's difficult, na? Because all you have to put a catheter into the anomalous pulmonary vein through the SVC, anomalous pulmonary vein. You might not be able to get it actually. So that is one point. So again, so that is one thing. So it's a So LSVC step up, RA step up, beyond RA, all chambers have almost the same saturation. LA mean is equal to RA mean, unrestrictive ASD, TAPVC with unrestrictive ASD. Right, so next, 2-year-old with poor feeding.
Should I continue, sir?
Let's see if someone else is willing to take up. No one else is there.
Yes, sir. 2-year-old with poor feeding. And SVC saturation is 58 and IVC is 59. Okay. And right atrium is 59.
What is the
count
on that? SVC, IVC saturation?
There slightly. Is low cardiac output is there, sir.
Yeah, slightly lower than normal. Slightly low.
Right ventricular is, RA is 59. Right ventricle is 52. And there is a step up at the level of PA, sir.
Okay.
PA saturations are 78 and left atrial saturation is 89. Left ventricular is also 89. And, okay. I don't know whether pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is not taken, which sample is not taken. Okay. Don't know where
you
the
step. You take that as the LA pressure. You can take the usually if you don't get the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, you take the LA as that.
Okay, sir. Okay. And LV is 89 and aorta is 90.
So there is some degree of systemic desaturation. So,
there is a step up at the level of PA.
And the LV pressures?
And left-sided saturations are decreasing. And coming to the pressures, right atrial is 4, mean is 4, right ventricle is 67. And PA pressures are elevated, mean is 40. And left atrial mean is 30. And left ventricular pressure is 124 by 12. And aortic pressures are 120 by 40. There is no significant systolic gradient.
Yeah. There's a white pulse pressure there. You can see
In aorta, there is white pulse pressure is there.
Okay, so your impression
maybe some up,
sir?
PDA with...
Okay.
Yeah.
Now you see PDA, there's a PDA accepted, but you can see the there is systemic desaturation as well as the MVO, mixed venous oxygen concentration is low. Okay, patient has poor feeding. So what will this indicate?
Heart failure.
Again, heart failure. Common is probably he's having a pneumonia or something like that, right?
Left atrial pressures are...
Left atrial pressures are not that high because...
respiratory infection.
That's a PDA with pneumonia is a diagnosis, right? So you have systemic desaturation. When you see an SVC concentrations are low, it's either a pulmonary malformation or something wrong with the lungs. Okay, in this case,
PDA may be associated anomalous LSVC.
Associated anomalous LSVC. I'm not very sure on that, but it's more common to have a PDA with pneumonia presenting at this kind of picture. Right?
Okay.
It's a more common diagnosis. So you have a low MVO2, you have the step up in the PA11, high pulse pressure. So it's a PDA pneumonia and PDA present with recurrent respiratory infections. So one question is they ask you is how do you distinguish between a PDA? I say it's an AP window. How do you distinguish between a PA and an, with the between a PDA and AP window on CAT study?
AP window, there will be early development of PAH will be there, sir.
on cath. You are doing the cath. Catheter is in your hand. See, in a PDA, what happens is an AP window, the catheter always goes into the ascending aorta. Right? In a PDA, the catheter always goes into the descending aorta. That's how you distinguish. Okay. So RA to RV to PA to PDA through into the descending aorta is a PDA.
Okay, the connection is at the level of descending aorta. The connection is at the level of descending aorta in PDA and AP window, it is in the level of.
Yeah, I'm talking about another things. Usually it goes in the AP window, usually. Again, there's a flow direction different, medial as well as lateral. I forgot which one is which. And PDA, I mean, I think I'm not very
PDA sure. PDA will be the lateral jet.
Okay, then maybe AP window.
Medial.
Okay, this is one usual question they ask.
And lung kappa can also be medium.
Okay. So, cause of PVD saturated lung pathology and pulmonary fistula. So, do a CAT study for a sick neonate. Even if you see the SVC saturation, it will indicate a sick neonate. So, anyone?
Okay. I will try that.
Yeah.
The SVC saturation is 50 and IVC saturation is also low. The patient with a normal aortic saturation is 68.
Okay.
Okay, and pulmonary artery saturation is 90. So this is a transposition physiology.
Okay.
Okay. Then SVC to RA, there is no step up. RA saturation is 54 and right atrium to right ventricle, there is a step up of 16.
Okay.
Then, pulmonary artery saturation is 90. Again, a step up from RV to pulmonary artery level. Pulmonary venous and left atrial saturation.
No, you cannot say step up from the RV to PA, right? Because PA is now the aorta. It's a TJ.
No, aorta.
So you read from the RV into the aorta. Okay.
So RV and aortic saturation are similar. Pulmonary artery pulmonary venous saturation is 98, LA saturation is 98, and pulmonary artery saturation LV saturation is 90. So there is a step desaturation from LA to LV.
Okay.
And LV saturation and pulmonary artery saturation are fairly similar. Mm-hmm. Coming to the pressure tracing. RA, the mean pressure is slightly elevated. RV pressure
patient is sinus rhythm.
Patient is in sinus rhythm. RV mean pressure is elevated. RA mean pressure is elevated. RV pressure, systemic pressure is elevated with a normal diastolic pressure. No gradient between diastolic gradient between RA and RV. Then pulmonary artery pressure is 100 bar 60 with the mean pressure of 75, and aortic pressure is 30 bar 15 with a mean of 18. So there is a significant gradient between RV to aorta.
Okay. So what is the diagnosis?
So this is a.
So whenever you see TGA, where is the shunt? Atrial shunt, ventricular shunt, or great artery?
Ventricular.
Ventricular. So is it restrictive or unrestrictive VSD?
VSD is
unrestrictive. Okay, again, you look at the RV systolic pressure and the
RV, and this is nearly similar.
Unrestrictive. Then your patient will survive, right? Restrictive VSD will survive. So TJ unrestrictive VSD. Is the next question, is there a PS or not?
What, sir? What?
Is there a PS or not?
Say, there is a RVOT obstruction is there.
Okay, fine. So it's a TJ VSD PS. Okay. RA mean is more than LA mean. Why is that? Normally it's the opposite direction. Now, why is the RA mean more than LA mean? Because of the PS. Okay. Pulmonary stenosis. So TGA, ESD, severe PS, CCF.
Here, aortic stenosis, sir, pulmonary stenosis.
Again, that is usually a controversy. Is the pulmonary valve part of the RV or is the pulmonary part of the pulmonary artery? So, okay. So whatever the chamber which is communicating.
You should say RVOT obstruction, no, sir.
Okay, fine. You can say
that. Systemic vessel obstruction. Hello. Then my connection got lost. Can we tell PS it is RVOT obstruction only? No?
Okay, you can say there is an RVOT obstruction. That would be better, actually. Okay, so that is clear, right? So again, it's a low cardiac output state also, right? So RA mean is more than LA mean, tricuspid ratio, pulmonary shunt or TAPVs. Okay, usually it's the other way around. So again, it's a sick patient. So here TCG, VSD, okay, RVOT obstruction with CCF. Okay, again, same question. CAT study for a sick neonate is the same thing. Everything. No, it's different. Okay, CAT study for a sick neonate. Sobin.
Oh, Jetta. Okay, I'll start with the saturation. SVC saturation is 68. It is fairly okay. And there is no SVC to RA step, significant step up or step down. RA to RV, it is normal only. RV to PA, also it is normal. Left side saturation, pulmonary vein saturation is 100. Pulmonary vein to LA, there is a, that is more significant, not too.
More than no. Two, okay, fine, yeah.
There is a step down at the pulmonary vein to LA. And LA to LV, there is a significant step down.
Okay.
Okay. And regarding the pressures, right side mean pressure is normal, slightly elevated. Sinus rhythm is like A is more than, yeah, A is more than V, slightly elevated mean pressure. RV pressure, RV systolic pressure is severely elevated. Okay. And there is no diastolic gradient between RA and RV.
Okay.
And RV to main pulmonary artery, there is a significant gradient, systolic gradient.
50.
And there is a main pulmonary artery to RP also, there is a significant systolic gradient.
20 is significant, okay. Yeah.
Sorry? It is significant, no? So
what does that indicate?
There is obstruction at two levels.
What levels?
Two levels. Branch and at the level of the valve.
Okay, so valvular PS and supravalvular PS. Okay, then.
Yes. LA mean is normal only. The LA pressures are normal.
Okay.
LV pressures also, it is normal.
Okay.
Descending aorta pressure is, there is a significant gradient. So there is a coart.
Coarctation of aorta. So you have diagnosed branch PS plus valvular PS plus coarctation of aorta. What else is there?
There is a step down at there is a significant step up at
step
up alla marannu poi endu parnondu vanne.
Okay, there is a step down at the level of ventricle, right? LV.
Yes, yes.
So what is the cause of that? See, you look at the main pulmonary RV systolic pressure as well as LV systolic pressure, they are both same.
Oh, yeah. RV systolic and I didn't get you.
See, RV systolic pressure is equal to LV systolic pressure, right?
Yes.
So there should be an unrestricted VSD.
Yes, yes. Okay.
Okay. So your diagnosis is there is branch PS with valvular PS.
Along with the coart.
PSD.
And coart.
With coart of aorta, right?
There. Yes, yes.
Okay. So again, note this RV systolic pressure is equal to LV systolic pressure, equal to the aortic systolic pressure, okay? This is a hallmark of TOF.
Okay.
Are you clear on that?
Yes, yes.
Okay, but is this a TOF? So question, elevated RV pressure indicates, causes the valvular as well as the peripheral PS. That is clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay, step down at the level of LA to LV, which is VST with right to left shunt. Okay, RV SBP is equal to LV SBP is equal to aortic SBP, and we have a coarctation. So you have severe valvular with branch pulmonary stenosis, with unrestricted VSD, with right to left shunt, right?
Yes.
With coarctation.
Yes. Yes.
So is this my question is this a TOF? Because I told you the hallmark of TOF is that the systolic blood pressures in the RV, LV and aorta will be the same. It is same in this. So is this a TOF?
Yes.
Wait, anyone says no?
No,
TOF is rarely associated with
coarctation.
That is the point. TOF is rarely associated with coarctation of aorta. Okay. Because from the beginning itself, there will be very good blood flow across the aorta from birth itself. So rarely from development itself. So that's one of the favorite exam questions. They'll ask you, is TOF associated with coarctation of aorta? TOF is not associated with coarctation of aorta. Okay. When we have good blood flow across an artery, that artery is rarely stenosed. Okay.
Right.
So that is the answer. So could this be TOF? It is not TOF. Okay. Any doubts on this? This no. particular case?
No.
Okay. So no doubts. Okay, fine.
So then so, what is the diagnosis, sir? Previous case?
This is a supravalvular as well as valvular PS. We have a VSD and a coarctation of aorta. We have multiple defects.
Any congenital anomaly?
I'm not sure about congenital anomaly, which causes all this. Okay. But like, I'm not sure about this. Any name syndrome regarding this, I'm not sure.
TOF physiology only, no, sir. This finally.
No, but it's not TOF. Okay, it's TOF physiology.
It may not be classical TOF.
Yeah, not a classical TOF. Yeah. Again, in this case, you start thinking, if you have a TOF with an associated coarctation, you think of a DORV. Okay.
So how to differentiate between valvular and branch PS?
You do a pullback, na? You'll get the different pressure gradients. Na? You take it deep into the pulmonary, right pulmonary artery and you pull back. You'll get a pressure gradient between two points and then you pull back again, you get another pressure gradient. Right?
Okay, sir.
So basically all these are pullback studies. If you, there's a pressure tracing class with us. So when you do a pullback, you can see multiple dips in that. If you do a pullback study. So when you get a TOF with a coarctation, you start thinking, is it a DORV, right?
Yes, yes.
30-year-old female, is an easy one. 30-year-old female, long-term asthmatic.
Then we will give to Danish.
Danish? Danish? Danish is not.
You want to take up easy one. Easy, I told you.
Okay, anyone else who is not from Trivandrum?
Surya ji, pasatala kopade.
Okay, somebody tell anyway.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
That is. Enne vilichano njan kaike.
Ninde level alla but you can attempt.
Then 30 year old female long term asthmatic with only pressures. Okay. RA pressure so patient sinusism. So RA pressure is 11. A is 11, V is 6, M 9. So all RA pressures are elevated.
A is more than V.
Then there is a diastolic gradient between RA and RV.
Okay.
Of 9. And the RV systolic pressure is 5. And the RV, it is elevated. And RV systolic pressure is also elevated, 60. Yeah.
Okay.
With pulmonary artery is showing a systolic pressure of 22 and diastolic pressure of 10 and mean pulmonary artery pressure is 40, not elevated. So, but there is a systolic gradient between RV and pulmonary artery. So, there is a pulmonary stenosis.
Okay.
RVT obstruction is there. So, then after that, coming to the LA.
Shall I start?
LA pressures are not elevated.
But and LV pressure... This is the
Might not have yes,
a yes. reason, a is, but A is more than V. Yeah.
A is more than V, correct. Okay. Then LV pressure 110/0 and aorta is 110/80. That is also normal.
Okay.
So here there is an RA pressure is elevated with A more than V with the RVOT obstruction. So maybe pulmonic stenosis.
What about the gradient across the tricuspid valve?
Gradient across the tricuspid valve, maybe TS is also okay. there.
So, what is the diagnosis?
TS with PS.
Carcinoid
syndrome.
Long-term
carcinoid syndrome.
So, the diastolic gradient across the tricuspid valve, the systolic gradient across the pulmonary valve, there's combined RV inflow and outflow obstruction. So, diagnosis carcinoid. So, first question, is there a PR in this case? Is there a PR?
RV and diastolic.
Danish.
PR. There is no PR.
Why?
PR only will there be a large volume.
What will be?
The will be.
PA diastolic
pressure. PR. AR will have a large aortic pressure and a low diastolic pressure. Similarly, PA also will have a large systolic pressure and no diastolic. Okay. So, what other condition will have TS and PS?
Yes.
Epstein's anomaly is being no okay. We can have it sometimes a large tricuspid defect going in, occluding him.
I'm going to go.
Santosh.
I'm going to go. I'm going to go.
Okay. So, 37-year-old female who is having dyspnea and exertion functional class 3. I think we'll give it to some other people. Saurabh, is there?
Yes, sir.
So you can read this.
I know your old female with dyspnea of exertion function class 3, RA pressures with A of 9, V of 8, mean of 7, then RV pressure 72.
Okay, now you must see patients in sinus rhythm with A more than V.
Yes, sir. Okay. And RV pressures are elevated with end, sir, ED is end diastolic pressure.
Yeah, end diastolic.
End diastolic pressure of 10. And pulmonary artery pressures are 68.
What is the on that RV
pressures? It's elevated and there is a
end-diastolic pressure?
End-diastolic pressure is also elevated.
Yeah.
So pulmonary artery pressures are 68/27 with mean of 34. So indicating pulmonary arterial hypertension.
And is there systolic gradient across the pulmonary valve?
Newton pressure on.
No, sir, not.
Okay, so no struggle. Then.
Then, LA pressures are A wave of 18, V wave of 16, A more than V, and with mean of 17, and LA pressures are also elevated.
Okay.
And LV pressure is 140 by and end diastolic pressure of 5, and aortic.
Is there a diastolic gradient across the mitral valve?
Yes, sir.
So around 17. Now, if you look at Cooey's formula also, if you look at Cooey's formula also, now you have like, what is it? Cooey's formula?
LA mean minus LVDP by 2.
So LA mean is 17. LVDP by 2 is 2.5. It's around 14.5. Okay.
So which formula is?
Cooey's formula. CUI.
Okay.
There is LA pressure.
Yes, okay. Sir.
Minus LVEDP by 2. It's not whole by 2, just LVEDP by 2. It's 17 minus 5 by 2.
2.5.
Yeah, so it's 14.5.
Yes.
And then a severe.
Sir, what it represents, sir? That 14.5?
It represents the mean.
Capillary wedge.
Mean gradient between LA and LV.
Yeah.
Ah, there.
Okay, so you have a severe gradient across the diastolic and across the mitral valve. Okay, then.
Then aortic pressure of 98/40. So severe systolic gradient across from across the aortic wall.
So what are your conclusions on this?
Sir, first of all, there is a significant elevation of RV and diastolic pressure as well as systolic pressure. Okay. There is pulmonary arterial hypertension.
Okay.
There is elevated LA pressures,
okay,
and with gradient across the mitral wall as well as aortic wall.
Okay, so causes?
Could be a simultaneous stenotic lesion of both mitral and aortic wall.
So you're saying severe AS?
With PH.
Severe AS, severe MS, PH.
Yes. Right? Yeah.
Okay, so
rheumatic heart disease.
Okay, so one thing is that look at the diastolic pressures in the RV. It is also elevated, right?
Yes, sir.
Indicates that the RV is going to fail.
Yes, sir.
Not yet failed because the RV pressure is 72. The RV is able to generate a very good pressure. So it's not yet failed, but it may fail because the end-diastolic pressure is slowly rising.
Okay. Yes, sir.
There is one more thing there. Whenever you get such kind of thing, whenever you diagnose PH, always look if there is an associated pre-capillary component to it. This is your routine post-capillary hypertension. Nah?
Yes, sir.
So you might have an associated pre-capillary component. For this, you either look at the diastolic pressure gradient, this is more accurate, or your transpulmonary pressure gradient. So you can look at the diastolic pressure gradient. It is LA mean minus a pulmonary artery end diastolic pressure. So how much is it?
27.
minus 10. So 10. More than 7 is indicates a pre-capillary component. Okay. Or you can look at a transpulmonary gradient, which is both means. Mean LA minus mean PA minus mean LA. So that is 17.
17. Yes.
And more than 12 is significant.
12.
So there's an additional pre-cap, or more than 12. So there's an additional pre-capillary component to it. There's an additional vasoactive component to it. You get my point?
Yes, sir. So it is both hyperkinetic as well as reactive pH.
It's reactive as well as passive transmission.
Yes.
So you have passive as well as a vasoactive component. You can have reactive component, obliterative component, as well as a passive component. Passive transmission of pressures. So one of the favorite questions they ask is, what are the types of pulmonary artery hypertension you can give in MS? And they'll ask you to grade it, and up to what grade can you get in MS? So all those are usual questions.
Yeah. Gradient to tell severe IS is 40 in cap.
Mean gradient and parayana, it's usually mean gradient, but it usually we make the systolic gradient only in cat study. 40
on a 50.
40. Okay, so it's severe IS, severe MS.
AR is there, sir. AR.
And mild AR, because you can see a white pulse pressure also, probably some mild AR. Okay. So diagnose severe MS with moderate pH with elevation of RV filling pressures, severe AS, mild AR, reactive pH is also present in addition. Okay. We have a diastolic pressure gradient of 10 and a transpulmonary pressure gradient of 17. So whenever you diagnose pH, always look, is there a pre-capillary component to it in addition? Okay. So let's say this is a 37-year-old female, right? Let's say this is a 67-year-old female. In which do you expect a pre-capillary component to be there? You get my question?
Yes.
No, sir.
See, you have a 37-year-old female and you have a 67-year-old female. Okay, both have the same disease, MS.
Yes, sir.
Which patient will have a pre-capillary common? More likely.
The young patient will have.
Young patient.
Young patient. That's why even in any congenital MS also, you have stronger, more pH in them. Because younger vessels will have more tendency to contract.
Juvenile MS.
Juvenile MS. Okay.
Okay.
So severe MS, moderate pH, the elevation of RV filling pressures, severe AS, mild AR, reactive pH. That is the importance of going step by step. You won't miss anything. So rather than jumping and straight away saying the diagnosis is MS, you don't miss any step, because they rarely give you any simple cases. Okay. CAT study for a pre-op 40-year-old. Only one more. There's only two. One more actually. So
CAT. Mitti,
come on.
Vanda.
There is Mitty. It's a very simple question. Very simple thing.
RA saturation is 58, high RA, and low RA saturation is 58. There is a step up from RA to RV, significant step up of 11%. Then there is a step down from LA to LV saturation, significant step down, and there is systemic desaturation also. Aortic saturation is 80. Then pressures, the RA pressure is mean is 7, elevate RA pressure sinus rhythm. RV systolic pressure is elevated 104, and there is a gradient from RV to PA.
Okay.
And the left side the mean pressures is LA pressure is 8, but A is more than V.
Okay.
Then LV pressures, there is no gradient, diastolic gradient across the mitral valve. So there is a there is
LV and RV pressures are the same. There is a VSD problem.
Restrictive or unrestrictive?
VSD with unrestrictive VSD.
Okay.
Aortic pressure is same. RV systolic pressure, LV systolic pressure, and the aortic pressures are the same.
Okay.
So probably. there is RV obstruction. Unrestrictive VSD with RV aortic obstruction.
Okay, so off is your okay. So step up in the RV, step up in the down in the LV, severe case. RV is not as good as LV, still the aortic still BP, it's tough. Okay. So are there MAPCAS? First question. Are there MAPCAS?
Okay. Yes.
Why?
No.
Oh my gosh.
Why?
Because pressure is not low.
There is no white pulse pressure to say MAPCAS.
White pulse pressure.
Okay. Next question. How was the LA
entered? There's no white pulse pressure.
How was the LA entered? There's no ASD. How was the LA entered? Don't say it goes to, you are going across the mitral valve. What does that?
PFO.
Yeah, exactly. It's entered through a PFO, probably through a proportent PFO. Is the patient operable? Next question.
Yes, sir.
Huh? Is the patient operable? Favorite question of examiners. Is the staff operable?
Anatomy we have to see, sir, rather than
simple TOF is operable. Usually simple TOF is operable at any age. Okay.
PA anatomy is...
you have to see the PA anatomy and all those things, but if you, as a general rule, if you get a TOF, it is usually operable at any age. Okay, there will be exceptions, okay, depending upon your PA and all those things. But again, if somebody asks you, TOF at any age is operable. That is one general dictum which you say. Okay, even simple TOF, you might get complex things, it's different. Okay, last question. 21-year-old boy presents with dyspnea exertion functional class 3. Okay, anyone wants to take it?
KK India.
KK and the KK. But Shivabal is in quarantine, right?
Vanji in a kandila, Vanji Muni.
Shivabal.
Parano, parano.
SVC 60.
Can't hear you, KK.
68 is normal. SVC to RA, there is no step up. 70. Then RA to RV also, there is no step up. PA saturation is normal. Then pulmonary artery wedge is 99, that is also normal. Then aortic saturation also normal, 97. But femoral artery saturation is low, 86.
Okay.
Then coming to pressures, mean RA pressure is 8, that is elevated. A more than V, patient in sinus rhythm. RV pressure is 105, that is also elevated. Then PA pressure is 105, systolic by 62, that is also elevated. There is no systolic gradient. Then mean LA pressure is 8, that is normal, with the V more than A. And LA so LV pressure is 100 by 8 and aortic pressure 100 by 70. That is normal. There is no gradient between LV and aorta. Here.
PDA Eisenmenger, sir.
Yeah, it's a PDA Eisenmenger. See, there's a definite saturation drop from the aorta to the femoral artery, na? 97 to 86.5. Right? There's a saturation drop na, from aorta to femoral artery.
There is the drop in saturation from aorta.
And with severe PH, what can be the cause P then? There has to be a PDA which is shunting from right to left. Pulmonary artery to aorta. You get my point?
Yeah.
PDA Eisenmenger. So patient is inoperable. Mostly inoperable, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so PDA Eisenmenger. So this is the last presentation. Okay, slide. So basically, when you get this CAT study, your diagnosis is not important. Okay, so they only look for how you read this. So you start with your SVC. You look for, you comment on the SVC. How good the saturation is. You go for the RA pressures, you look for the AAB, comment upon the patient's sinus rhythm, look for diastolic gradients across the tricuspid valve, go for the RV, systolic pressures across the pulmonary valve, comment on the wedge pressure or LA, systolic diastolic gradient across the mitral valve, LV pressures, and a systolic gradient across the aortic valve. And then you comment on each step in an oximetry pressure tracing. So the method of how you read is more important rather than how you just don't jump and say a diagnosis. Just don't jump and say PDS. So you must try to rationalize out why it is PDI isomer, because they usually bring you some complex tracings, okay, and which the you have to not miss a single point. That's more important than simply and simply saying a diagnosis, because the diagnosis which you say is rarely correct. So always go sequentially and stepwise. All right, so I think that's for the presentation. So thank you very much, and stay safe.
Shivaal is missing, Jetta. He was in quarantine. Something fishy.
Yeah, he's in quarantine. Tarun is also right now exposed.
Yeah. Are already compromised.
Group of yours in which we can enroll, sir, for regular classes in future?
I'm not sure. This is the first class I'm taking, actually. There was one which Thomas had, which was pressure tracings. Na?
Hey. This is a very useful class for us.
It was very methodical and helped us, sir. So any future class, sir, we'd like to join. Thank you, sir.
Okay, we can ask the rep, actually. Yeah, Arjun,
sure, onda? Sir. Yeah, onda, sir. Udon.
Future, yeah, definitely, sir. Parayin, hindi, yanam?
Onda, sir. We'll be happy to do that anytime. Only thing, I want your request, that's all. I mean, from your help. Anyway, thank you, for sir, for such a captivating deliberation, first of all, sir.
Okay, sure.
Anyway, we are there. We are already there. We'll be shoulder to shoulder. Anytime, we are ready to do that.
So, okay, then you can even conduct a class next week. Let's see how.
Sure, sir. Whatever help you require, sir, just feel free to call Arjun, sir.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
Okay, sir. Sir, on the behalf of JP Chemical, sir, we would like to thank you, sir. Such a nice presentation, sir. I mean, accepting our invitation. Such a nice person, sir. Thank you. And I would like to thank all the participants who have participated here.
This it was such a motivating crowd, sir. Almost we are touched close to 49. So it's quite fabulous.
Actually, it's a very appreciable.
Yeah.
And on behalf of JP Chemical, sir, in fact, our deepest gratitude and admiration for the sacrifices you make every day during this pandemic, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
In fact, products, almost our products are familiar to you, sir. Of course, nothing new, sir. Silacar, of course, our bread and butter. Bisotab, our brand of Bisopolol, also it is available.
Sure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good night.
Bye.